But it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Heather Perry, an associate professor at the Department of History at University of North Carolina, Charlotte. She teaches a variety of courses, including on modern German history, the First World War, medical history, war and medicine. She's got some fabulous books out there, including Feeding War, Nutrition, Health, and National Belonging in Germany, 1914 to 1924. She has edited Food, Culture, and Identity in Germany's Century of War. That just came out in 2019. And is a powerhouse in the world of First World War studies. It is truly my pleasure to pass the proverbial mic over to Dr. Heather Perry.
Great. Well, hi, Laura. Thanks so much for inviting me. Thank you to everyone who's out there. Laura knows how much I really, really want to be there at the Museum and Memorial. It's one of my favorite places. And that's even more so now that I found out about the food that you're having from Afera. I actually have it down on a list now of the things that I want to do the next time that I get to come out that way. But as I said, it's one of my favorite places, and it's exciting to talk with everyone who's out there now, and those of you who will perhaps be watching later. I want to just give a really big shout out to Laura and everybody at the museum, who I know have been putting in a Herculean effort in terms of finding new ways and new technologies to try to bridge this pandemic divide and reach out to people. You know, she and her group and many other museums have just had to deal with unprecedented issues, and it really kind of warms my heart how much you've kind of spent time and energy dedicated to helping us still reach people. So thank you for that, and thank you also to every one of you who are out there. So today what I want to do is to talk with you about some work that actually is part of this book that I'm still working on, the Feeding War book. And so you're kind of getting some sneak preview of that. I'm gonna share my screen, and I'll begin with a slideshow, which I'm pretty much gonna follow through with the whole talk. But as I said, I really hope that you will put questions in, and I'll try to answer them as I can. And it should be up now. No?
Looks great.
Okay. As the title indicates, what I want to focus on today, or the part of the book I want to focus on, is how the war impacted ideas in Germany about food, gender, and identity. And I'm using this phrase, the long great war, which I think will be clearer by the time I get to the end of the talk, because one of the things that really interests me is the way in which the war experience actually is something that kind of transcends some of our typical datelines. And I suspect people at the museums would agree with me here that the aftershocks of the war, so to speak, make it a long experience. So I'm just gonna dive in and I'm gonna begin with this quote from the Berlin Mayor's press release in December of 1927 for a new exhibit that was just opening up. He begins, "The war taught us many lessons in the field of nutrition. Before the war, no one racked their brains over the big pictures of how to organize national nutrition or how to create the building blocks of nutrition. However, during the war, we learned that deprivation and scarcity of food can actually have a good impact for the nourishment and health of mankind." Now, this might be a surprise for those of you who know a little bit of something about Germany's World War I experience. But this is just part of, in the spring of 1928, the city of Berlin unveiled really the most ambitious public health exposition undertaken in Germany since before the war. Housed in the expo halls, and you can see an image here on the Kaiserdom, the exhibit entitled Nutrition, an exhibit on healthy and practical eating, combined the latest scientific research, economic considerations, and practical advice on food and how to eat it. Comprised of dozens of different installations, Nutrition offered the public easily accessible information on the bioscience and physiology of this nascent field of nutrition. It outlined the nutritional value of common foods and foodstuffs. It detailed the latest developments in industrial food production and processing, and displayed cutting-edge kitchen technologies. Most importantly, however, the event showcased information on how to cook and serve healthy meals, meals that would promote not only individual fitness, but ultimately they hoped contribute to the long-term health and revitalization of the nation. Nutrition aimed to take the advancement in research born from a decade of food insecurity and economic desperation and put them in the service of those who, as far as the politicians, civic leaders, and health professionals who had put the exhibit together were concerned, really held the fate of the nation in their hands, the German Hausfrau. So today I'm going to talk about the broader impact of the Great War in Germany by looking at it through the lenses of food and gender. And while most World War I historians have focused on how wartime food scarcity, hunger, and deprivation on the German home front contributed to military defeat, social division, and political revolution, what I want to do here is shift that conversation and instead kind of focus on how different social groups in Germany experienced and responded to that food insecurity, both during and after the war. And so then, as I mentioned, this is part of a bigger project that's looking at really the practices of wartime food management and kind of dialing down on the German scientific communities, health and wellness groups, and women's organizations, and looking at how those long-term impacts of the coping strategies ultimately reshaped not just German ideals about health and gender, but also, I argue, national belonging. Well, so I want to first just give a few words about the significance of food in World War I Germany, for those of you who may be unfamiliar with that. The wartime mobilization of food is an aspect of America's World War I experience that is familiar to many. Posters urging Americans to conserve food and limit consumption so that they could support the Allies overseas are really some of our most enduring images of the war in America's collective memory. But it's important to remember that the American wartime food experience was in many ways incomparable to that of Europe, and especially for Germany. And that's for one primary reason. America had enough domestic resources to feed itself, whereas most of Europe did not, even before the war. A highly industrialized nation, the German Empire had become heavily reliant on food imports to feed her population of 68 million long before 1914. And rather than kind of go through a bunch of long lists of statistics, what I just want to do is kind of show you two slides, two graphs from some contemporary studies that I think do a good job of kind of illustrating these differences quickly and succinctly. So if we just, again, I'm not wanting to bore anyone out there, but I just want to draw your attention to some of these quick figures. You know, the U.S. is producing, 5,334 millions of dollars worth of food, whereas in Germany and the United Kingdom, just to give you an idea, that's anywhere from one half to one third. But more importantly, I want you to take a look at these figures where the UK, right, is only able to produce about 53% of the food it needs, and even Germany, which can produce more, just 88. And so if we just looked, for instance, at wheat import and exports before 1914, what this graph makes clear is that Russia and the United States are far overproducing just any other nation out there. And in fact, what this cross-hatching here shows us are actually the amount that they're able to export to foreign markets. And if you were to look at France, Italy, Germany, and United Kingdom, you see these huge black squares. And that's an indication of how much they needed to import in order to feed their population. And so, I think these are kind of striking images of the extent to which both the UK and Germany were dependent upon imports, and they were just one of many agricultural and food items which were sourced from foreign countries. And I'm not going to belabor this point by offering you a laundry list of everything they didn't have, but I do want to emphasize how heavily both the German Empire and the United Kingdom relied on imports and how very aware both nations were of this when the British imposed their naval blockade in 1914. You know, the British blockade of Germany was initially a traditional one focused on seizing munitions and war material, but almost immediately officials on both sides began calculating how long Germany's food supply would last. And during the fall of 1914, the British began expanding their definition of contraband. By the winter, England's Royal Navy was blocking, seizing, or sinking all commercial imports to Germany, and soon Germans were referring to the brutal and illegal British strategy designed to target civilians and starve the nation into surrender as the hunger blockade. And indeed, here are some studies that were already in 1914, both in England and Germany, trying to determine the extent to which Germany would be able to survive. So cut off from most outside resources, the German government realized really almost immediately that only by carefully managing their limited resources could the nation emerge victorious in the war. And they created a number of war offices, which I won't go into, but these agencies became responsible for procuring and distributing raw materials, mostly for munitions and military supply. But as the war shifted from one of stalemate to attrition over that fall and winter of 1915, and the blockade remained in place much longer than anyone had anticipated, it really came down to food, procurement, management, distribution, storage, and preparation that became, over the course of the war, the most valuable resource. And as crisis loomed, an unlikely set of laboratory researchers stepped in to advise their nation at war. So nutritional science was born in the laboratories of German research universities in the 19th century. Through his experiments with humans and animals in the 1860s, the Munich chemist Carl von Voigt had discovered the basic laws of metabolism and had been establishing the foundations for nutritional chemistry and physiology. Voigt is still actually considered by many to be the father of modern dietetics. His pioneering studies on protein metabolism in the human body established the baseline energy requirements and how to measure them. But by the turn of the century, his student and intellectual successor, Max Rubner, had emerged as Germany's leading physiologist and nutrition expert. In 1913, a year before the war, he helped to found the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute for Work Physiology in Berlin, subsequently becoming its director. And in the years before the war, Rubner had been focused on conducting research with the goals of determining what the ideal diets, that is the nutritional and caloric content, would be for optimizing the productivity of various professional and skilled workers. And here I'm kind of giving you some images of the studies. Rubner was really fascinated with trying to figure out how much energy the body needed. What were the ideal sources for this energy? How might mental and physical work differ in their energy uses? And when the war broke out, he saw the chance to use his knowledge in the service of his country by advising civilians on the home front how best to maximize the food available to him. Rubner and other scientists argued that despite being isolated from previous imports, the nation did not need to fear starvation. With some simple habit changes and food substitutes, Germans would be able to adjust both their appetites and their stomachs to the nation's existing food resources. And in fact, some seized this as a moment to chastise Germans for having become accustomed to eating far too much before the war. In addition to outsized portions or meals, they also opined that many Germans tended to eat out of habit and not actual hunger. Thus, they took aim at eliminating mindless snacking and promoted mindful, more efficient eating practices. They urged Germans to reach for food which had higher levels of appetite satiation, such as potatoes, over that fare which they argued had been scientifically proven to be less satisfying, such as bread. And all the while, they wielded scientific food studies for evidence as to why Germans should be making these conscious decisions. If Germans would only eat more efficiently, they repeated, they could feel fuller while also consuming less food. Additionally, they argued that Germans needed to learn how to use food and ingredient substitutes while still preserving the taste and value of standard dishes. They suggested that rye and potatoes and other root vegetables would be good substitute for the wheat that they now lacked for breads and other baked dishes, and which partly explains the creation or evolution of Käsebrot or Kriegsbrot, war bread. The war bread was rejected by most Germans as too dry and unappetizing. Over time, citizens came to find that these were actually qualities that enabled the bread to remain fresher and last longer than white flour loaves. And here you see a postcard, one of many attempts to kind of sell the German public on the happiness and joy one could get by eating this war bread. They also tried enlisting other home front authorities to help them in swaying public opinion towards war bread, such as the pastor Bernhard Dörries. In sermons such as this one, he not only urged his flock to consume the bread as part of their national duty, but he also reassured them that it was what God wanted the good people of Hanover Kleefeld to do. So nutritional chemists urged Germans to be more judicious in their protein consumption. According to one report, Germans ate far more red meat than necessary for sustenance, and they urged citizens to cut back on its consumption to conserve protein. Another nutritionist, Carl von Norden, an expert in diabetes nutrition and management, argued that the average German's protein consumption had actually risen far too high in recent years. And he was of the opinion that especially worker families needed to cut back. In fact, Rubner and others were so concerned about the population's mismanagement of protein that in 1915, they urged the slaughter of over 9 million pigs. And while many historians have blamed the infamous 1915 pig massacre on the ineptitude of Germany's bureaucrats, I think it's important to remember that the empire's foremost experts in nutritional science were the primary advocates for this action. According to their scientific calculations, twice as many Germans could be fed on the grain being used as animal feed, rye, corn, and barley, than could actually be fed by the meat that produced by the animals which consumed this feed. So in addition to kind of this advice on meat consumptions, they wanted to convince Germans that skim milk had the same protein and nutrients as whole milk, and thus could be used without fear. This was a particularly hard sell because most Germans at this time considered skim milk just barely good enough for livestock, and the idea of cooking or baking or even drinking it was really abhorrent to them. Mothers were urged to breastfeed infants to impart important nutrients to them and to stop relying on cow's milk or wet nurses. So one of the things I hope that you're kind of picking up is that on the one hand, they're offering this food advice, but implicit in there are kind of some of the underlying messages are certainly criticisms about German behavior that are classed or gendered. Or certainly sort of linked to other identities. But you know, Rubner and his colleagues are convinced that the key to successfully stretching the nation's food supply was not just eating less, right? Germans needed to eat more carefully to maintain physical health and strength and consume enough of the right kinds of calories while also being mindful not to overeat or waste specific food items. Now, I realize that today, we might take this kind of nutritional information or advice as common knowledge. But in 1914, this was still rarefied scientific knowledge that did not really circulate beyond the university laboratories and research institutes. So for instance, there's no such thing as a kind of a dietary nutritionist or a lay nutritionist who advised people about healthy diets or weight loss. That's all much, much later. But for Rubner and his colleagues, educating Germans about these building blocks, and they had just recently discovered proteins, carbs, and fats, how to recognize them, what foods contain them, how much the body needed, became an important home front mission. In essays, talks, and addresses, the nation's scientific experts aimed to use the war as an opportunity to demonstrate not just the usefulness of their research, but also to reform the daily eating habits of the average German. Postcards and images like these would have kind of circulated in this session. We'll hold out, and you see here a potato, and you may not be able to see the K here and the K here, but this is representing war bread, Kriegsbrot, and Kriegswurst, war worst, and the idea being that these are the home front troops that are kind of help the population hold out. But here's the thing. What Rubner and others had failed to realize was that their suggestions for surviving wartime food challenges were essentially futile if they could not convince every one of the nation's 12 million households to adopt them. By 1915, it was already becoming clear that urgent yet vague directives from the government to be sparing or eat less did little to regulate effectively the consumption of Germany's food resources. It was not enough, they discovered, to simply put the information out there. Suggestions which included fundamentally changing daily habits, breaking with traditions, acquiring new tastes, and altering favorite family recipes stood little chance of being adopted without the help of one important segment of society on board, the German Hausfrau. Indeed, in the absence of such regimented and precise instruction, they discovered to their dismay that actually better off Germans had been practicing saving measures by buying up bigger quantities of cheaper food supplies, which meant that while they did increase their stores, what was left in the markets was often unaffordable for those Germans of lesser means. Also, because many women were unfamiliar with the new substitute ingredients or fuel-sparing preparation measures, frugal-minded housewives on the home front were reluctant to experiment with what little food they had. What nutritionists discovered was that women needed practical and handy information on how to implement their suggestions. It was the housewife who chose the menu, did the shopping, prepared the food, and received the family's praise or criticism regarding the daily meals. And so when nutritional advisors and food reformers deliberated how they might best accomplish this re-education, they turned to Germany's household experts. One such household expert was the household reformer and domestic maven, Hedwig Heil. Born in the 1850s and raised in Bremen, Hedwig Krusemann was the daughter of a wealthy industrialist and North German Lloyd shipping magnate, Edward Krusemann. At 18, she married the chemical dye manufacturer, Georg Heil. And when she was widowed at the age of 49, she not only took over his businesses, which is pretty unusual, but she also turned her focus towards educating German women in household and servant management, child rearing, social etiquette. She was known not only for her household training school in Berlin, but perhaps even more importantly, the best-selling culinary tome, The ABCs of Cooking, right here. Weighing in at a hefty 900 pages, this volume had just gone into its 11th edition the year before the war broke out. Well, Hale had long been active in promoting proper bourgeois housewifery. In 1906, she even organized an exhibition on the topic in Berlin. But the exigencies of war spurred her to further action. And in 1915, she founded the League of German Housewives as a way to create a reliable and efficient network for educating women and spreading wartime advice for how best to withstand the food shortages. And I really love that just this particular printed pamphlet, because what this says in German is the war of the German housewife against the English hunger blockade or starvation plan. So you really sort of see how they're using this rhetoric and kind of positioning housewives as having kind of this special purchase and skill. So Hale sought to expand her practical work with Berlin women throughout the empire through this network and actively worked to spread nutritional cooking and household information through this formal network of housewives groups. She even converted many of her late husband's chemical dye plants and manufactories into canning centers for preserving fruits and vegetables, and sometimes used those spaces to instruct women on how to do so at home. In fact, Heil's early efforts at educating and helping the German women to stretch and preserve food were so instrumental that her fame carried across the Atlantic and throughout the United States. In St. Louis, Baltimore, El Paso and Norwich, Connecticut, Americans could read articles about the most powerful woman in Germany, known in some circles as Germany's food general or the female Hindenburg. And here you can see this one from the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, calling her the Hindenburg of German housewives. Touting her success at helping to prevent starvation among her people. Well, Nutritionists saw the advantages of joining forces with women such as Heil and began working with their groups to organize classes, lectures, cooking demonstrations, and regular publications aimed at housewives and domestic workers, giving them this practical advice on how to deal with challenges. In Berlin, women's groups worked together with the medical community to host lectures and exhibitions on how to cook using different fats, while in Hamburg, authorities organized groups which could visit the estates of wealthier Germans and instruct their entire household staffs in these measures. Cities across the empire created home economic advice centers where women could get practical information, and even public test kitchens called war kitchens, where recipes could be tested and demonstrated to local residents. Here you can see images of posters advertising courses or sort of slideshow lectures that women could come and visit. And this one is about kind of save soap, but how? And so they could come and learn sort of different measures for that. This was a slideshow lecture that they were giving on how to recognize wild vegetables and weeds so that women would be able to collect them and use them in cooking without, you know, perhaps choosing poisonous ones. Elsewhere, domestic science schools and their students were enlisted as collection stations for fruit, stones, and nuts, which could be used for extracting oils. As this poster from the War Committee for Oils and Fats tells us, Berliners could earn 10 pfennig for every kilo of cherry, apricot, and plum stones that they turned in, or even 35 pfennig for each one of lemon or orange. The National Women's Service also posted information about how best to use or reuse what before the war most women had considered kitchen waste or animal feed. This poster here on the left suggests new uses for potato peels, while this one on the right not only reminded them to dry out their allotment of rutabagas, but included instructions on how to do so. Newspapers circulate information about where to find additional information or additional classes, as well as weekly sample menus to give Germany's women suggestions on how to use the meager food items they were able to gather that week. And so here we see kind of one of these city housewife kind of advice centers, and it's offering an entire sort of weekly a meal. And this here is a part, something I've taken from a newspaper, which is called a kind of continuing or ongoing cookbook. And if you notice, it's specifically for Northwest Germany, meaning that this is kind of organized around sort of the food and tastes available in that region. The war cuisine, as they started to call these tactics and strategies of frugal cooking and household management, was a constantly evolving set of practices and information which changed as food supplies rose and dwindled, usually dwindling to be sure, over the course of the war. What's key here though is it wasn't a one-time educational task. It was conceived as an undertaking that required continual updating and readjustment. And one of the best ways to do this, they discovered, was through regular publications put out by regional chapters of Heil's League of German Housewives, as well as other organizations. Over the course of the war, women of all classes and educational levels published dozens of instructional pamphlets and manuals designed to keep Germany's housewives apprised of developments in nutrition, war cuisine, frugal household management, and patriotic cooking. And I'm going to show you here just some sampling of some of these pamphlets and books that they published. And the thing that I always kind of pull out of here is that while those initial ones were written by doctors and sort of couched in the scientific knowledge, what we see in these later ones is a real sort of attempt to appeal directly to housewives through members of their own community. So even while this is a book on sort of national nutrition and guidelines, but it specifically targets the German Hausfrau and even has this kind of slogan up here on top saying that the housewife must help in winning the war. So rather than presenting this information as sort of criticism or admonition, it's really presented more as kind of enlisting women into a common project. Cookbooks for each region were developed, specifically designed to include recipes for dishes that were familiar to local residents and which made use of native ingredients more likely to be available as well. So for instance, cookbooks in Mecklenburg and Pommern and other northern areas, such as this one that was specifically for Baltic women, usually included fish and dairy dishes with appropriate substitutes, while dishes in, those cookbooks aimed at middle and southern areas such as Bavaria might include suggestions for meat-based dishes which substitute rabbit or poultry for the beef. This here was a war cookbook put together by a kind of radical social reformer, Henriette Fort, for the City of Frankfurt's Food Commission, and included an introduction from the Committee for Popular Nutrition, which had been formed by local doctors. The point I'm kind of making here is that the Frankfurt Food Commission reaches out to her and commissions her to put this together, and then kind of legitimizes and contextualizes it with this broader health and medical community. And I could go through a lot of these, and I'm not gonna do that, but I'll just point out two more that are kind of interesting or perhaps typical. One, these cookbooks might include attestations that the recipes therein had been tried and tested by Germany's housewives and positioned them or promoted the recipes as not ones that were being kind of handed top down and they use this phrase, know-it-all scientists, but rather kind of suggesting that these were ones that were kind of proven and popular among families. And then this one, the new war cuisine cooking guidelines for meat and fat saving days in 1917. And here you'll see that in fact, the author, Josephine Nagel, is getting sort of prominent pride of place. And she's the author with a sort of short introduction by this professor, Carl von Oppenheimer. So the point that I'm making here is that these women, housewives, politicians, teachers, mothers, were taking lead in educating their fellow women and working in conjunction with health and nutrition experts. So kind of what I'm suggesting here is that this is a kind of moment of uplift where we're seeing this kind of strange or unprecedented relationship between these research laboratory doctors and working housewives, and it's forging a kind of partnership that is in many ways legitimizing both sides, right? The knowledge and the skills and the recipes on both sides of that relationship. So in contrast to the kind of regional specific recipes, however, there were other publications that aimed at educating women on more frugal cooking techniques, such as this one instructing German women on how to cook with the Kochkiste. And the best translation I found of this is the hay box stove. So the hay box stove relied on using hay or other insulating materials to extend the cooking period of pots or baking dishes without using more of an already scarce resource, coal. By packing the pots into these boxes and covering with lids, and I think I've got kind of an image here, by packing the pots into here, surrounding it with peat or hay or other insular material, and then sort of shutting this lid, the residual heat of the pot would continue cooking the meal, the contents, long after the pot had been removed from the stove or the oven. And so what I'm making here is that there are manuals circulating that are including more than just modified recipes, but also kind of more technical or scientific knowledge, which would have been new to many women. Over time, these manuals evolved to include even more educational information. Take, for instance, this 1917 cookbook devoted to the rutabaga. Not only did the new rutabaga war cookbook, and just the very fact that it's called the new rutabaga war cookbook suggests that there must be an original one out there somewhere and I just haven't found it. But the new rutabaga war cookbook included 50 different recipes for rutabagas, one of the few vegetables more readily available in 1917. But it ordered these recipes around regional flavors and ingredients. And I think here you get kind of a list of all 50 of them that would appeal to anyone. You could make a rutabaga appeal to anyone's particular proclivities or tastes. But in addition to just the recipes, however, it included a history of the rutabaga, a description of how best to store it before and after cooking, right? So information to make the rutabaga feel like a more familiar or user-friendly vegetable, an explanation of how to best calculate the vegetable's nutritional value per fennig spent, right? So involving sort of math calculations. Also a chart of the daily nutritional requirements of the average man, woman, and child. And finally, a table listing the nutritional value of the most commonly available foods. So what I'll put out to you is that the new Rutabaga War Cookbook is more than just a cookbook, right? It's a primer on nutritional science and frugal housekeeping for the nation's kitchen soldiers. And as nutritionists, housewives, and municipal leaders worked together, the message that they were sending Germany's women was that the blockade was making daily decisions about food matter in unprecedented ways, and the nation's very survival depended upon their skills and knowledge within their own private home. So I could continue with more on that, but I wanna not take an entire hour, but talk a little bit about the bigger significance, or when I'm teaching with my students, I call this the so what or who cares question. I could regale you with a longer list of specific cookbooks and advice manuals, but what I wanna do now is to move to a discussion of the significance of all of this. So it would be easy to dismiss all of this information as simple wartime emergency measures, right? That this was just practical advice that was made necessary, right? Only during the war, right? So necessity being the mother of invention, and discarded in 19 once the conflict was over, except that it wasn't. In fact, what most or many historians have overlooked, those who study war and food, is that while the war hostilities may have ceased in 1918, food scarcity and other resource crises extended well into the 1920s. Some of you are probably familiar with this hunger map. The blockade, for instance, remained in place for another 7 months as part of the Allied strategy to pressure German leaders into signing the Versailles Treaty, which they eventually did at the end of June in 1919. But even then, the political and economic chaos continued long into the 1920s. The citizens of the new Weimar Republic contended with social revolution, civil war, political assassination, repeated coup attempts, foreign occupation, and last but not least, the unprecedented and devastating hyperinflation of 1923. To make a long story short, food insecurity continued in Germany long after the war itself ended. And in fact, research, contemporary research, research then and now, suggests that actually the food situation was even worse after the war during the armistice and reconstruction periods than it was during the war itself. And this matters because even though Germany's men were demobilized as military soldiers after 1918, most of Germany's women continued in their roles as kitchen soldiers until at least 1924. So food rationing continued in some areas until 1921, and American relief groups such as the ARA did not consider Germany to be food secure until 1924. Now the Quaker food relief organization that had set up even sort of as soon as the war was over, actually left in 1923, but then came back because the food situation continued to be so dire. And this political and economic situations in Germany really didn't stabilize until 1924. And by then, the national experience of food insecurity had lasted a full decade. Many wartime practices had become habits. As just one example, ready-made spice packets from Maggi and Knorr, which had been promoted as easy fixes for flavoring food when butter and fats were scarce, had become common household items by then. Moreover, Germany's women had not only become accustomed to considering ideas about nutrition and health alongside frugality when making household decisions, many had embraced the scientization of the kitchen. Information about vitamins, nutrition, and more scientific eating became a staple subject in women's publications and magazines. So when we look at women's newspapers in the post-war period, such as Land und Frau, Wirtschaftsfräulein, Die Gutsfrau,
We see articles on nutrition and emerging vitamin research, the kind of scientific information which would never have been part of women's popular publications before the war. And this is a page from the Wirtschaftsfräulein, which included information and images from the actual nutrition exhibit itself. So just to kind of get back to where I began today, which is that 1928 exhibit. After running in Berlin for nearly 4 months, 100 days to be exact, parts of it then transformed into a traveling exhibit, which visited different areas of the country to educate the public, including Stuttgart, Dresden, and Leipzig. And so here's an example of it from the when it got to Stuttgart. And these images I'm just going to show you now are actually from the proper nutrition exhibit that was in Leipzig later in 1928. But what I hope you can see is that while on the one hand, there's certainly an instruction on how to properly set a table and serve a meal, this being the sort of proper, well-mannered way to do it, and this from the sort of ill-mannered or ungeschickt in German sort of household. So clearly we know who's being targeted here with this with these exhibits. You could also find information on how to prepare certain foods, and these sort of looking at spices and other techniques, but also clearly scientific education. For instance, materials on the average nutritional needs of humans, right, where they could sort of look at a comparable visual information, and the scientific importance of minerals and regulated calories to a healthy body. And here they could look at acids and salts and how and why that was necessary for blood and metabolism. So, and I think, I've got one more. This was a kind of visualization of how the body expends energy during a typical 8-hour workday. So again, like trying to give women images and sort of a broader understanding of this science. So just to kind of conclude here and wrap up, while the Berlin mayor and other exhibit sponsors understood the information within nutrition to be of most use to German women, and their speeches and publications all reflect this, the other message that health exhibits and magazine articles were sending to everyone, not just housewives, was that nutritious eating had become intimately linked with national health. This helps to explain why government, welfare, health, and schools partnered with scientific researchers and appliance makers in 1928 to put together the most comprehensive exhibit about nutrition and food that the world had ever seen, including its centrality to national identity and survival 10 years after the war had actually ended. So it seems clear that the wartime mobilization of Germany's kitchen soldiers ultimately began a nationwide public conversation about health and food and individual responsibility, even civic duty, that all Germans had to cultivate and maintain it. And so what I'll kind of end here then with is that the war in the kitchen was not just one of propaganda and patriotic rhetoric. It also wasn't just one of invention born of necessity, but it became one as well of nationalization and public health. And kind of as I'll argue some other time, it was just the beginning of German women's perpetual mobilization as the nation's kitchen soldiers in the tumultuous 20th century. So I will kind of leave you with this little image here once more of the nutrition exhibit and stop sharing. I can't see anyone out there, but I hope that you're still there.
They absolutely are. There are a lot of people who are here with us. And I apologize because if you are in the audience, you know that and you come to these regularly, you know I normally ask, where are you joining us from? So if you haven't yet added that in, we would love to know where you are joining us from today. in Facebook Live, put that into the chat. In Zoom, same space, put it into the chat. If you're joining us in Zoom, we would encourage you to put your questions into the Q&A, but don't worry, some of you have been adding it into the chat and I have been taking note. If you are in Facebook Live, add those in to that chat as well. Thank you all. And thank you so much, Dr. Perry. We really appreciate your expertise. If to the audience, if this is one of your first conversations about food, I would encourage you to take a look at our first one in this series. This is a really nice bookend that was with Helen Veach. She was talking about the American experience. And so when you see these two conversations back to back, you can see many of the similarities, but also many of the differences. So the first question comes to us from Joe Cleary. When U.S. women started food programs in the spring of 1917, do you know whether they used Heil in any sort of organized way?
So I don't. At that point, it would have been really difficult for her to get overseas again to visit the U.S., but probably even more importantly, of course, the rush of American patriotism and kind of the turning tide within kind of the United States had really moved against German culture in a lot of ways. And this even included ideas about health and welfare. So I wrote another book about prosthetics and artificial limbs in World War I. And as soon as America entered the war, all the German doctors refused to use any more American artificial limbs because they considered it really bad form. And we see a similar rejection on the American side of German ideas. So my gut reaction is that no, they really would have wanted to do things differently than the Germans.
You mentioned a lot of workshops and test kitchens, et cetera. And I think that these were happening kind of over the course, not just during 1914 to 1918-19, but in the early part of the century as well. Did those actually really help?
Well, we don't have a lot of kind of information on the day-to-day use of them. What we do know, or kind of what I've been able to piece together, is that certainly women went there eager to learn strategies. And what is probably harder for historians to pin down is the extent to which then they used those strategies consistently at home. But absolutely no doubt these kind of model kitchens would have been crucial for them learning how to use new kinds of foods or new kinds of techniques. Even more importantly, they could actually taste the food. And so even when food became really scarce, sometimes going to a model kitchen was a way to get a little, perhaps a little extra nourishment. But that's actually stuff that I'm continuing to research. And what I'm finding super interesting is that a lot of the household courses that were being developed, right, and they differed much, right, they differed a lot from that which had been before the war, which is mostly about etiquette and kind of motherhood, is that right now what I'm looking at is how the information in those courses that sort of taught during the war actually start becoming staple information in the young women's schools and domestic household schools after the war. So it does become more kind of routine information or sort of assumed that it should be common knowledge.
And thank you, because you took that question the way that it was actually worded, and I had broadened it out to the arc of Heil's career. So thank you for that. Linda asks an additional question. Are there some popular recipes that came about in that time frame that we might still be using today?
If you were German, you would know about probably one of the most common things ever. It's Eintopf, which means kind of like one pot or sort of stew. And if you were at, if you were at university and you went to the mens or the canteen, you could probably one of the cheapest portions you could get is Eintopf. And it literally is kind of catch-all. And Eintopf is such a common dish that permeates the entire kind of German food vocabulary that I dare you to find any German who doesn't know what Eintopf is.
When you say that, actually, I'm going to shift to a different one. The question from Zoom here, did the U.S. do a similar nutritional study? Was Germany the first country who started doing these sort of nutritional studies? Thank you, Ute.
Oh, that's a good question. Helen Zoe Veit is a much better expert on that. She and I have had some really interesting conversations. So laboratory research, like the scientific nutritional research, was definitely far more advanced in Germany. Right. And so Germany was the research, scientific research center of the world at this time. So American scientists would have actually gone to Germany to train under them and learn more from them. So certainly those ideas would have trickled down. And I think that part of what Helen points out is that there's a broader arc in the US in terms of how these ideas are adopted and promoted, and perhaps linked a little bit less with war, right? Because the American experience of war is so brief, and more, I think that, and I don't want to speak for Helen, so don't kill me, Helen. That maybe it's sort of more linked with kind of conceptions of modernity in the United States and kind of embracing being a modern nation.
And if you are interested in Helen's book, it is titled Modern Food, Moral Food, and I believe it's on sale at the Museum and Memorial Bookstore online. Next question. When you say that Frankfurt physicians legitimized Heil, do you imply that she had no official role as far as the government was concerned? More probably, did the German government involve housewives officially in the wartime effort?
So that's a whole part of the story I didn't even get to tell you. So let me try to do this concisely, which is hard for every historian, I have to say, in my own defense. In Germany, the war effort kind of drastically shifts in 1916, and the nation invokes and implements a number of programs which all together are part of the shift to total mobilization. And one of the things that they invent and put into place in 1916 is the War Foods Office. So it's a office within the War Ministry that's just about food management. And in fact, the War Foods Office created its own Women's Advisory Council, and Hedwig Heil was part of that. So for me, that's a whole nother level of the story, ways in which women are, like Heil, are kind of in the back door to German government. So absolutely.
Heather, we still have several questions. Would you be willing to stay on about 10 more minutes to answer some questions?
Sure, if I know the answer.
Fantastic. Sure. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you are joining us, I do want to be true to your hour. Thank you so very much for being here, for learning more about this topic of warfare and how food itself is so integral to who we are in communities and so much a part of our history. Thank you for being a part of this series that we have done and enjoying some of the foods, if you are here in Kansas City, of our local restaurants. Now, if you are not here, I would encourage you to go out and enjoy your local restaurants, whether by carryout or the like. They, just like your cultural institutions, need your support right now. Thank you so much for joining us. Dr. Perry, thank you. But down for just a moment more if you want to answer some questions.
Yeah, in fact, I see a really good question from, I hope I say this right, Roy and Judy Nickum about Shaver.
And I think you're going to be able to say the word that I've been avoiding. So for that, again, stay on for the rest of the Q&A. If you want to end, if you are heading out, thank you so much and join us again, either online or on site at the National World War I Museum and Memorial soon.
Thanks so much. So Schrebergarten, actually, I took that part out of the talk because I didn't want it to be this overly extended talk. But so, you know, Schrebergarten were implemented, really created in the 1860s, right? It's kind of part of a health and outdoor movement. And it's like these allotment gardens, so like small community garden, which is on kind of public lands usually. Throughout the end of the 19th century and early 20th century, in city areas, it was really associated with the working class poor.
And that either those were sort of gardens that they needed because they didn't afford their own food, or that was the green space that they went out and visited kind of for rest and relaxation. And if you've ever seen these little allotment gardens, right, they're not super big and they're just sort of patches. So there's just, you know, 50, 60 of them all lined up in a row. So, you know, middle-class Germans would go off to the seaside or the mountains. But anyway, there is a shift. There's actually several communities around Germany begin founding more of these allotment gardens. Some, they kind of rename them a little bit. They don't call them victory gardens like they do in the US, but they call them, like, you know, these like garden colonies, right? So it sounds like you're doing this adventurous thing and colonized. But yes. And in fact, for some areas of Germany, 1915, 1916, it marked the beginning of the Schreber movement coming into those communities. Because, you know, Schreber was in Leipzig, kind of Eastern Germany. So yeah, it's actually, that's a whole nother story. Like all the garden manuals, I could go on, I'm gonna stop.
So Linda wondered, why was there so much starvation in Russia in your hunger slide earlier, when Russia made more than it needed in your earlier production slide?
It did. And one of the problems that Russians faced, much like Germans, is when governments called up soldiers to the war effort, they called up a lot of farmers. And in fact, as the war became more industrialized, working class men of kind of any nationality usually could get an exemption from the government to go back to the home front and work in the munitions plants, because munitions were so important, which meant that often more and more farmers and sort of farming communities kind of lost their labor. So on the one hand, over the course of the war, you're having repeated harvests which aren't being fully harvested, right? And so that grain and food is going lost. Then with Russia, you know, in the midst of their double revolution in 1917, two things happened. When they signed the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk with Germany in 1918, so much of that gets apportioned to Germans, and they begin sort of trying to send that into Germany. But also Russia kind of devolves into civil war. And it's that civil war period from, you know, really from 1918 to 1922, 23, where the government is requisitioning just whole communities, whole regions of wheat for soldier needs, and then to be truthful, there are some forced famines that happen in the kind of early Soviet Union, where part of the strategies to pull some of these outlying areas under control were to kind of implement, orchestrate famines. So yeah, the Russian food situation is tragic.
And Heather, if memory serves me correctly, my class many, many, many years ago, there's also a shift of the railroad gauge crossing Russia as well, that they had to actually take some of the produce off and wait, and then reload it onto a different, the appropriately gauged, to be able to go from gauge to gauge railroad. Am I right on that, or is this just a dream of old history classes?
Now, I wish I knew, because now you've stoked my curiosity, and I'm going to have to look it up.
The nice thing is, actually, all of you who are still watching, Google is right there at your fingertips. So yeah, you can check out and see if I am completely wrong, which I very well could be. So I'm going to get you right onto your next question.
But Laura, I will say this, you know, governments had nationalized railroads and had kind of kind of commandeered them for troop movement and other, you know, hospital trains. So the competition for resources would have been difficult. And of course, one of the best things to do, right, like we know from Lawrence of Arabia in the Middle East, one of the best things to do is to blow up other nations' railways.
And that's a really nice, that was a really nice ad for, you all will see in April, we are starting our Lawrence of Arabia Legacy Lecture Series as well. There will be three lectures plus an outdoor screening in the summer. This is the great part about staying for the extra Q&A. You get all the insights. There's going to be an outdoor showing of Lawrence Arabia on the grounds. So inside scoop before it's even hitting the actual marketing stream yet. Come out and see it. Find out more about what Dr. Perry right there is talking about. Now, Parker asks, in terms of percentages of food stocks and malnutrition post-war, how much of an impact did it have on Germany, especially with the ongoing British naval blockade during the Weimar Republic era?
Yeah, so the blockade, you know, lasts until essentially June 28th, 1919, when the Germans signed the treaty. And so after that, there's no formal blockade, but international commerce is really tricky at that time, because there are, on the one hand, lots of nations who continue to kind of blame Germany for the war or harbor resentment. When Germany goes through that period of hyperinflation in 1923, there kind of like fear ripples throughout international trade markets, and a lot of nations just kind of want to shy away or sort of back off and don't want to have anything to do with the German economy, this kind of the sense that it might be catching, so to speak. And then of course, when the French occupy the war, right, because the Germans don't have anything, right? They don't have any money, they don't have food, so like they have to sort of pay reparations and in-kind goods and all this other stuff. So stocks and stores, there wasn't much really by the war's end, but what they were able to build up were often, for instance, by the French in the early 20s, just kind of hauled away, requisitioned. There just wasn't enough. And America's, Hubert's still bringing food to Germany in 1923 and 24. Is that kind of a long answer to your question, maybe?
And again, that's the benefit of staying in the extra session. I would love to draw your attention to some of the things going on in the chat. Do take a look. We have got some recipes being shared here with us. Thank you, Uta. That looks amazing. I'm not going to try to pronounce that, but do take a look. Check out a fabulous recipe. In response to Dr. Perry's earlier conversation about what might be something that was kind of formulated at that time frame and that people still use, it looks delicious. Thank you for sharing that. Also, Mary, thank you for reminding me, if you have more interest in Russia, we did do a conversation a few years ago about vodka with Patricia Hurley. So feel free if you want some more information. There's actually some good stuff in this book right here. Fortunately, people think that this is just a prop. This is my real bookcase that I have to reorganize every time I talk with you guys. Also, a question about wanting to learn more about German history in World War I. Two really good books. One you might have read if you are from the U.S. You might have read this book, All Quiet on the Western Front, in high school. But here's another one, if you haven't run across this one yet, mm-hmm. Ernst Jünger's Storm of Steel. It's another really great book, particularly if you are teachers. Two good books to be taking a look at. And of course, you do not want to miss out on Dr. Heather Perry's books. Can you please give us the titles again?
Recycling the Disabled. I can't believe I'm in my office at school, so I can actually hold it up. So this is my book about orthopedics and artificial limbs and disabled veterans. And then the one about war and food in Germany. And as soon as I'm finished with this one, Feeding War, I guess I'll send it over to the World War I Museum and Memorial. I won't send it. I'll bring it because, I can't wait to go back.
And have a little a bite, and we will prost over at a fair just down the street. So again, thanks to a fair. Thank you to you all who are staying and enjoying the rest of the conversation. And Dr. Heather Perry, thank you so much. It has been a delight to be in conversation on this Spring Forward Sunday with you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, everyone, for attending. I really, really am pleased to be able to do this.